Imagine that you're standing in a field on the plains of Western Russia, and by some strange quirk of fate, you've had to stand there for a whole year. You have witnessed snowy winters, fresh springs, warm summers, and wet autumns. Incredibly, if you've chosen a spot 1,300 kilometers to the west on the borders of Germany and Poland, or 2,700 kilometers east, deep into the Central Asian steppe, then your experience wouldn't have been hugely different. This is because all these places, spanning 4,000 kilometers from east to west, are in the same climate zone, the warm summer continental climate. If one were to travel from the Atlantic coasts of Mauritania across the Sahara, the Nile Valley, Arabia, southern Iran, to arrive at the estuary of the Indus River at Karachi in Pakistan, one would have experienced every day on that 8,000 kilometer journey to be more or less the same, since this whole region is within the hot desert climate zone. The fact that one can experience the same climate across thousands of continuous kilometers makes their opposites even more incredible. Now imagine that you are on a cool, foggy coast of California, and that you get in your car and drive for about 30 minutes over a set of coastal hills into bright sun. It's only when you get out of the car that you're amazed to feel the hot breeze blowing over your face. In just a few miles, the temperature climbed 14 degrees Celsius. How is this sudden change possible? What other areas of Earth see dramatic shifts in temperature, sunshine, and rainfall in only a few short miles? And in what other ways? Well, the answers lie in the subject of microclimates, the latest case of my climate casebook. A microclimate is defined as a noticeable change in long-term weather patterns over a short distance, typically within 20 to 30 kilometers. As climate is principally defined by long-term patterns of precipitation and temperature, we are primarily concerned here with the sudden changes in temperature and rainfall, although, as we shall see, other atmospheric effects such as fog and cloud enter in. I have identified five essential ways in which microclimates might come about: proximity to ocean water, altitude, slope direction, built environment, and plant cover. Let's look at each of these in ascending order, starting with plant cover. Anyone who has walked from a field into a forest on a hot day will have felt the sudden cooling of the air, whether it be in the tropics, temperate, or subarctic regions. Forests can drop the air and ground temperatures by considerable margins throughout the year in the tropics, and on sunny summer days in temperate and subarctic regions. This cooling is the result of the shade provided by the tree canopy and the cooling effect of evapotranspiration of water from the trees into the air. In winter, however, the effect is reversed, with forests being slightly warmer over a 24-hour period than the open lands outside due to the dark foliage absorbing more heat from the sun compared to lighter grasslands or indeed snow. Next, there is the built environment, a fancy term to describe buildings within cities. When large areas of the surface are covered in concrete, asphalt, and brick, they absorb much of the heat from the sun during the day, then radiate this out at night as they slowly cool. This radiative effect also occurs during the day but is not as strong. This phenomenon is known as an urban heat island and can result in large cities being several degrees warmer than the surrounding countryside. And then there is slope direction. In valleys that run east-west in the northern hemisphere, the northern slopes that face south receive the sun at a steeper angle to the ground compared to the opposite slopes, and so will be significantly warmer. This effect is noticeable in wine-growing regions of Europe and can affect which grapes would be grown on which slope and at what time they would be harvested, since this crop is notoriously sensitive to temperatures and humidity. Next, we have altitude. As I covered in my Subtropical Highlands episode of Secrets of World Climate, air cools as altitude rises. Anyone who has driven up a mountain road will experience this in just a 30-minute drive. In summer, the top is noticeably cooler than the bottom of such a road, while in winter one can experience going from a snowless terrain into one where there are meters-thick snowdrifts on each side of the road. In some cities built on steep slopes, such as La Paz in Bolivia, this can result in higher parts of the city being cool enough to be in a different climate zone. A less obvious effect of altitude occurs in certain low-lying areas surrounded by mountains, which can produce much colder winter temperatures than is typical. Cold air is more dense than warmer air, and so if left undisturbed in such topographical conditions, will sit over an area in what is known as a cold air pool. In fact, the coldest winters outside of Antarctica, experienced by the lucky town of Verkhoyansk in northeast Siberia, are enhanced by this effect. Okay, so these effects are all valid as microclimates, but in my view the most noticeable and famous microclimates occur in the final category, the proximity of ocean water. If you've been watching my other series on climate, then you'll know about the moderating effect that ocean water has on lands nearby. Think of the mild climate of the British Isles compared to the subarctic climate of eastern Siberia at the same latitude. But this effect occurs over thousands of miles and so is not in microclimate territory. But there are three ocean effects which can occur over local distances, and we'll look at each of these in turn. The first is the ocean providing year-round frost-free conditions in the oceanic climate of Britain and other places that otherwise experience regular winter frosts. Why is this important? Well, because practically all tropical and many subtropical species of plants have evolved in climates that experience no frost, and so if exposed to it, can die off in just a couple of nights. This effect occurs in several places in Britain, but only in sheltered coastal areas, including the southern coasts of the counties of Devon and Cornwall, and certain spots in northwest Scotland. This has led to the remarkable situation in these places where palm trees are part of the streetscape, 1,000 miles north of the palm line of the northern Mediterranean. The reason for this is that Britain receives the warm Gulf Stream ocean current, which is responsible in general for that mild climate at these high latitudes, but in particular for local spots right on the ocean that are also sheltered by surrounding hills that prevent cold winds blowing out from the interior that would otherwise bring frost. The second type of ocean-generated microclimate occurs on tropical and subtropical islands subject to trade winds. As I mentioned in episode 2 of my Secrets of World Climate series, trade winds are the consistent winds that blow in subtropical and tropical regions, almost always coming from one general direction. When such winds hit a mountainous island, this will have the effect of producing orographic lift of air on the windward side, resulting in high rainfall and leaching the ocean air of its moisture, such that the leeward side of the island is much drier. If you have ever visited the Hawaiian Islands, the Canary Islands, or indeed some Caribbean islands, you will see quite dramatically the effect of this on the landscape. Windward sides are lush and forested, while leeward sides just a few miles away are covered in grassland, shrubs, or even in some cases desert. My own personal experience of this was on visiting Gran Canaria in the Canary Islands, which has been dubbed a continent in miniature owing to its incredibly diverse set of climates and biomes, despite being only 50 kilometers in diameter. On one afternoon, I drove from a resort on the south coast to the capital of Las Palmas in the north. This took only about half an hour, but in that time I went from a desert landscape and blistering sun over 30 degrees Celsius to grey skies at 20 degrees, and lush green landscapes. The final microclimate effect that I'll look at in this video is that of a cold ocean meeting hot land. This occurs exclusively on the eastern margins of the oceans, where they meet temperate westerly coastlines. In these areas we find Mediterranean or desert climates, both of which experience hot and dry summers, but the ocean currents passing down these coastlines have come from polar regions and so carry cold water. Needless to say, putting these two factors together is always going to create interesting effects. In one of these areas, the coastline of Peru, I discussed this in detail in the previous casebook episode, where that city experiences frequent fog and low cloud, and yet just a few miles inland, the air is clear and temperatures much higher. Now, the capital of Peru, Lima, is no small city, having 10 million population. But in the areas of Greater Los Angeles and the San Francisco Bay Area of California, up to 30 million souls experience the well-known microclimates of these areas. San Francisco is famous for its rolling fogs, and anyone who has visited the city will likely have experienced them. They are the result of a layer of cold, moist air rolling in from the Pacific, trapped beneath warmer, drier air above. This air soon meets the hot, dry air of the Central Valley of California and dissipates. In just a one-hour drive from San Francisco to the inland city of Tracy, the air temperature on any given summer afternoon can rise by as much as 14 degrees Celsius, with the July average high in Tracy being 33 degrees, while in San Francisco it's only 19 degrees. An even more dramatic effect occurs around the City of Angels, where at the coast in Santa Monica, the August afternoon temperature can be 21 Celsius with low cloud, while Santa Clarita, just a 40-minute drive north, is 14 degrees warmer at 35 Celsius. The reason for an even more compressed change in temperatures is that here we have two ridgelines along this journey that separate the cool ocean air, known locally as the marine layer, from the hot, semi-desert interior of Santa Clarita. I experienced this phenomenon personally on many occasions during my time living in this region. And no, I haven't forgotten you, San Diego. You experience this effect too, to the degree that local TV weather spots provide a microclimate forecast during the hot months of the year.
You stay classy, San Diego.
And that's microclimates. I hope you enjoyed this rapid sketch of these peculiar climatic phenomena. If you did, then please leave a like or comment, and I'd especially love to hear from you if you live in an area that experiences a microclimate. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel if you haven't already done so, and enable notifications so you don't miss future episodes. If you'd like to support the future development of these videos, then please consider becoming a Patreon supporter for as little as $2 a month. Thanks again for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.